and welcome to another episode of the Literary Lutheran Reads a Book of Concord. Today we will start Article 21, the Invocation of Saints. Note, Melanchthon says that after numerous protests, all the confutation has done is proved that the saints should be honored and that living saints may pray for others, which is all the Lutherans said to begin with. In Roman Catholicism then and still today, the saints take on a non-biblical role. The saints are said to have a storehouse of merits that they use to intercede for us. Melanchthon provides a careful discussion of what a propitiator, atonement maker, is and is not. Only Christ may be called a propitiator. Only the merit of Christ is counted as meritorious for us in God's eyes. This Lutheran assertion, then as well as now, stands in stark contrast to what Rome teaches about these things. Melanchthon rightly points out how, in popular devotion and practice, Mary has completely replaced Christ in the minds of many. This is still very much a problem in Roman Catholicism today. They absolutely condemn Article 21 because we do not require the invocation of saints, or no other topic do they speak more smoothly or wordily. Yet they are not able to prove anything other than that the saints should be honored or that living saints pray for others, as though invoking dead saints were necessary for that reason. They cite Cyprian because he asked Cornelius, while he was still alive, to pray for his brothers after his death. By this example, they prove the invocation of the dead. They also quote Jerome against Vigilantius. On this field, they say, 1,100 years ago, Jerome overcame Vigilantius. So the adversaries triumph as though the war had already ended. Nor do those asses see that in Jerome against Vigilantius, there is not a syllable about invocation. He speaks about honors for the saints, not about invocation. Before Gregory, none of the other ancient writers mentioned invocation. Certainly, this kind of invocation and the opinions that the adversaries now teach about the application of merits are not confirmed by the ancient writers. Our confession approves honoring the saints in three ways. The first is thanksgiving. We should thank God because he has shown examples of mercy, because he wishes to save people, and because he has given teachers and other gifts to the church. These gifts, since they are the greatest, should be amplified. The saints themselves, who have faithfully used these gifts, should be praised just as Christ praises faithful businessmen. Matthew chapter 25, verse 21 and 23. The second service is a strengthening of our faith. When we see Peter's denial forgiven, we are also encouraged to believe all the more that grace truly superabounds over sin. Romans chapter 5, verse 20. The third honor is the imitation, first of faith, then of the other virtues. Everyone should imitate the saints according to his calling. The adversaries do not require these true honors. They argue only about invocation, which, even if it were not dangerous, still is not necessary. Besides, we also grant that the angels pray for us. For there is a passage in Zechariah chapter 1, verse 12, where an angel prays, "O Lord of hosts, how long will you have no mercy on Jerusalem?" We admit that, just as the saints, when alive, pray for the church universal in general, so in heaven they pray for the church in general. However, no passage about the praying of the dead exists in the scriptures, except the dream taken from the second book of Maccabees, chapter 15, verse 14. Furthermore, even if the saints do pray for the church, that does not mean that they should be invoked. Our confession affirms only this: Scripture does not teach the invocation of the saints, or that we are to ask the saints for aid. Since neither a command nor a promise nor an example can be produced from the scriptures about the invocation of saints, it makes sense that conscience remains uncertain about this invocation. Since prayer should be made from faith, how do we know that God approves this invocation? Without the testimony of scripture, how do we know that the saints know about the prayers of each one? Some plainly ascribe divinity to the saints, namely, that they discern the silent thoughts of our minds. They argue about morning and evening knowledge, perhaps because they doubt whether the saints hear us in the morning or the evening. They invent these things, not to honor the saints, but to defend profitable services. The adversaries cannot produce anything against this argument. Since the invocation of saints does not have a testimony from God's word, it cannot be affirmed that the saints understand our invocation or, even if they understand it, that God approves it. Therefore, the adversary should not force us into an uncertain matter, because a prayer without faith is not prayer. For when they cite the church's example, it is clear that this is a new custom in the church. Although the old prayers mention the saints, they do not invoke the saints. This new invocation in the church is unlike the invocation of individuals. Further, the adversaries not only require invocation in worshiping the saints, but also apply the merits of the saints to others. They make the saints not only intercessors, but also people who make atonement. This cannot be tolerated. Here, honor that belongs to Christ alone is completely transferred to the saints. The adversaries make them mediators and atonement makers. Although they distinguish between mediators of intercession and mediators, the mediator of redemption, they plainly make the saints mediators of redemption. Without the testimony of Scripture, they declare that the saints are mediators of intercession. This, be it said ever so reverently, still clouds over Christ's office and transfers to the saints the confidence of mercy belonging to Christ. People imagine that Christ is stricter and the saints more easily appeased. They trust the saints' mercy rather than Christ's mercy. They flee from Christ and seek the saints. So they actually make the saints mediators of redemption. Therefore, we will show that the adversaries truly make the saints not just intercessors, but atonement makers, that is, mediators of redemption. Here we will not describe the abuses of the common people. We are still speaking about the opinions of the doctors. Regarding the rest, even the inexperienced can judge. This has been the Literary Lutheran Reads the Book of Concord, and I wish you a blessed day.